Hello, good afternoon and welcome again, everybody. End of a wonderful festival, but I'm glad to see so many faces. We are going to be talking about across genres, a topic which is very, very important, and it's of great interest to me. I'm going to start off with a little personal story over here. And I'm a teacher, and I love teaching reading and writing, and particularly embracing literacy. And I have a huge personal classroom library. So every year, what I do is I show my kids, the students, I lead them to the classroom library and I say, you know, the last year's kids, they had no idea about books, they had no idea about genres, and look at this mess that they've left this library in. And you are now in charge of categorizing the books and putting them according to the way you want, and this make this library your own. So what happens is that we take all the books off the shelves, we put them across the floors, there are books everywhere, on the chairs, on the tables, near the trash cans. And for somebody who's a neat freak like I am, this is a very, very, you know, jittery exercise, but I go through it every year because what it does is it gets people's hands, the kids' hands on the books. And more importantly, what it does is that it starts conversations about books. So, you know, to give an example, for instance, you have a book about folk tales. Now, is it fiction? Is it fantasy? Is it about animals who talk? Is it about, does it have legends in it? What is it? It's up to the reader to decide in some ways. So I'm hoping to do a little bit of this unboxing the boxes, the genres that we have created for ourselves in company of wonderful panelists that we have over here. We have, I'll start from Mishi, who writes across genres herself. She writes novels, she has written a wonderful travelogue, she's written nonfiction, she's written articles, and her latest book is set in the 1930s Shanghai. We have Neelum Saran Gour next to me. Six novels, four short story collections, two nonfiction, translated her own novel. She writes reviews and articles, and her latest book, Requiem In Raga Janki, is there, was launched recently as well. And on my left is Makarand Sathe, a well-known playwright, and who's also written this wonderful three-volume anthology about Marathi theater. He also regularly writes for articles in newspapers, and as well as translated a lot of his own work. So I'm going to start with a guiding question over here for all of us, and then I'll let everybody speak. And that is, it's a question that was in my mind, and it was, does the work dictate the genre, or does the genre dictate your work? Like, what comes first, the chicken or the egg kind of syndrome? So Mishi, would you care to talk a little bit about your work in response to this question as well?
Okay, so I guess the thing that I started out as a journalist. And the reason I started out as a journalist was not really anything particularly thought out about genre, or that I had this desperate interest in journalism. It was just that I wanted to write, and I couldn't think of a way to earn money while also writing. And this seemed to be sort of a convenient marriage of the two things. And it just actually seemed to be amazingly ideal as a young person to be writing all day and to be paid for it. And I thought this was just the most amazing, stunning discovery. And actually, I used to think in the newsroom. I used to work for Reuters as a news reporter. And I used to think that in the newsroom, that all these people are actually just waiting for the moment when they can become novelists. And I realized quickly that actually that wasn't the case at all. It was just me. Because I guess my whole journey, in a way, has been towards becoming a novelist. In terms of reporting, though, it was an extremely interesting career. I learned a lot. It does teach you a central tenet of writing, which is, what is the story? and you learn to look through all the layers of information that people are feeding you and try and get to the nugget of what it is that is important. You're sifting through data and through emotions and through angles. And of course, the story, what is the story, is dictated by what the news organization in particular wants you to write about. So I've, at the end of a certain point, I found myself, you know, I would be sent out as a young reporter to go and cover IPOs and financial news. And I would find myself sitting there and looking at the IPO announcement and the numbers and what they expected this particular stock to be doing. And thinking instead of all that, I found myself thinking, well, what did this guy have for breakfast? And, you know, does he have a good relationship with his wife? And actually, what is his wife doing at this point? And I realized that these are not very reporter-like questions at some point. And indeed, I was getting less and less interested in journalism. And I needed sort of a broader canvas for writing. And that's when I decided to throw it all up and go and travel and see if I could, if I couldn't explore a different way of writing about the world. And that was that's how my first book came about. I decided to take a year off, and I got a grant to travel, and I was in Hong Kong at this point, and I packed up everything and put everything in storage, and bought a backpack and set off on the tracks of this Chinese Buddhist monk, Xuanzang, who went from China to India. And that to me seemed to be a very convenient and happy trope, but to explore a way to write about this man and this journey. And it was, I intended it right from the start to be as well a sort of an inner exploration. I mean, people said to me, I remember, you know, aren't you taking a telephone and like a mobile phone? This was in the days before smartphones. This was 2000. And I couldn't imagine myself needing a phone. I didn't really want to talk to anybody. And then people said, you know, don't you need a camera? What about taking a camera? And I thought, no, I don't want to take pictures. I want to try and do it in words. I want to engage with my world through words. And then once I finished the book, everybody kept saying, you know, are you a Buddhist? You know, this was a Buddhist monk. I kept getting invited to conferences on Buddhism, which I ducked every last one. And then, am I a travel writer? But no, there wasn't another travel book I wanted to write. It was just this particular journey. And I realized in some ways it was for the monk Xuanzang, it was a pilgrimage. And for me, it was a pilgrimage towards writing, I suppose.
How many more minutes?
Okay. For me, it was also a way of clearing up a lot of issues about identity and who I was as this Indian woman born in India, lived in India for 10 years. But my father was transferred all over the world. And I ended up doing Chinese and Chinese studies and was living in Hong Kong. And Xuanzang's journey was a way for me to find a way to my roots. And I remember this moment, I was in Orissa and waiting to cross Chilika Lake in one of those little boats. And I would get this response, you know, I would speak my kind of Hindi for what it's worth. And in Oriya, people would understand more or less. And then they would look at me with such surprise and say, oh, she's Oriya. They wouldn't say she's Indian. They'd say she's Oriya, as in like that she's from here. But that here was a very specific here. It was their here. It wasn't my here. And then I remember being this other moment when I was in Chennai, actually in Kanchipuram, because this monk, this Chinese monk, went all the way to Kanchipuram. And I remember sitting in this restaurant and suddenly this this Hindi song came up. I think it was Mohammed Rafi or something. And I was South Indian. I'd been hearing South Indian languages. I traveled through Andhra and Tamil Nadu. And I hadn't heard Hindi and Urdu in a very long time. And all of a sudden, I realized, you know, I was so homesick. And I realized, but I'm in India, you know, how can I be homesick? And I'm in India. And I realized I'm homesick for a particular language, and I'm homesick for a tiny little geography. And in that realization, those realizations along the way kind of blew apart my whole question of what it means to be Indian and have an Indian identity. And also this, the way people looked at me as an Indian woman traveling through India, you know, I would arrive, that concept of traveling alone through India is so foreign as a woman that I would arrive, they couldn't believe that I was Indian. I would arrive at monuments, and old monuments in India, foreigners pay a much higher price than Indians do. And they kept saying, you have to pay 300 rupees. And I'd say, but the price says Indian, it says 30 rupees. They'd say, but you're not Indian. And I'd have to actually produce my passport, because this concept of being an Indian traveling alone as a woman through, I mean, it was just, people could not fully understand this. So that was interesting as well. So that book came out. Lots of issues, I thought, were put to rest. I was living in Hong Kong at the time. And then my husband was transferred to Korea for a short while, and then to Shanghai, back to Shanghai, which is where I... China is where what I had studied. I had spent a few years there as an exchange student. And in Shanghai, I had this idea for this amazing novel. It was going to be set in Shanghai. It was going to be, I knew exactly what it would look like. And then I started writing it. And then this novel kept moving back to India. You know, the characters kept going somewhere else. And I realized this other thing had to be written first. So that was The Other Side of Light, which is my novel, which actually has nothing to do with India. With China. It's set in India, and I wrote it while I was in Shanghai. I had just landed in Shanghai. We hadn't even unpacked our bags. And I realized The Other Side of Light was sort of a leave-taking. It was me writing a life in India that, it was a life that I imagined I might have had I lived in India. So, how many more minutes? Should I keep going? Okay. So that was the second book. Then I did all this amazing research on Shanghai, on the history, the character that I had in my mind. I researched the development of the city and this incredibly buried sort of history that Shanghai has. And it was this onion-type situation, slowly unpeeling the layers and getting deeper and deeper into the story of Shanghai. I got a little distracted. I keep getting distracted, I realized. While I was researching this novel, I came across the story of this Parsi gentleman, J.B. Tata. And I explained to him, I ended up... interviewing him. He was 93 years old. He had grown up in Shanghai. And I said to him, Mr. Tata, I'm writing a novel and I'm researching this novel. But the more I researched his life and the story of his life in Shanghai, I realized, no, this cannot be in my novel. This is its own story and has its own momentum, and this has to be a nonfiction thing. And so that's what happened with that. So the novel, you may have noticed, is still unwritten. But I finally, after the Stray Birds in Huang, the History of Indians in Shanghai came out, I'm now able to go back, and I've actually finished a rough draft of this novel that I first conceived in 2006. So to sum up, I guess you could say that when I look at writing and my use of different kinds of writing, I mean, at this festival I've heard many people talk about glass and mirrors, and yes, it's absolutely true. To me, it really is. If journalism is a transparent pane of glass, and then novels and plays are the glass getting a little bit thicker, and poetry finally is perhaps the frosted glass or the mirror, but it's a continuum of the same thing, you might say. And I guess I'll finish by saying that, in a sense, it's been 30 years of looking at China, being involved with China, and sort of some throat clearing in preparation for finishing the novel that I'm working on now. if that makes any sense.
Thank you. Yes, that's really illuminating. I remember, Neelum, when I was talking to you, you mentioned a lot about how this concept of freewheeling, and you ride across genres, so I'll let you speak about what that is for you as well.
First of all, I must make a confession. I find it very difficult to be theoretical about my work. It is the work that speaks. So I can only add a footnote here or a footnote there. I feel that as you write, the work assumes a life of its own. So in an earlier session, I compared this particular novel that I'm going to talk about to a rag, because a rag is fluid and it is fixed. It has its notation, but there are improvisations. Now, today I'm going to speak about the novel as a river, because this novel is both rag and river. Water is always water, but it is contained in different molds. And often the writer cannot really interrupt the flow of this river. And if this river wants to include many different genres, in order to realize itself, you just have to go along with it. So in this novel, there is fiction, there is biography, there's autobiography, there's poetry, there's musical bandishes, compositions, and folklore. And believe you me, I mean, it's almost as if the novel had a will of its own. So I find it difficult to just analytically speak about it. I think I'll read a part of it to you. So you can see the way the book is flowing from genre to genre with a mind of its own. I have to tell you the context. The book is about a famous singer called Janki Bai Allahabadi. She was one of the great singers of the gramophone age, although she is not remembered. The context is that Janki, you know, Janki was ugly to look at. She had no star presence. She had been attacked when she was a child with knives, and that is why, and the story is that 56 knife stabs had scarred her face and her hands, and that's why she was called Chappan Churi. So Janki fell in love with a lawyer. This is based in Allahabad, a lawyer called Abdul Haq. And Abdul Haq was also flattered. He knew she was very rich. So at one point of time, she found that he had stopped coming to her programs. And she asks the famous poet Akbar Allahabadi why this had happened. And he tells her that, you know, he is having a problem. He is canvassing for the municipal elections of Allahabad, and his candidature is not being accepted because you have to own property in Allahabad. Now, Janki had become very rich. She had many houses. So she thought that she would gift Abdul Haq a house because she had lost her heart. She does gift him that house. And then she starts writing love poetry privately. And after that, they are married. She has converted to Islam. And their love talks come out effortlessly through Thumris. And then suddenly the marriage soars. Alienation sets in. So slowly a kind of bitterness enters the relationship. Now in flat narrative, it's taken me about a paragraph or a page to outline this. But I do it in this passage. So I'll just read it out to you. And perhaps you will see the streams slowly moving in different tributaries, swelling a mighty river. This is the time when she decides to go to Abdul Haq and tell him that she's going to give him a house. That evening, she ordered her phaeton. But when Samina asked where the coachman be directed to go, she only said, Mehdori village, in a voice that discouraged any further inquiry. And when Samina made preparations to accompany her, as she always did, she said no. Not today, Samina. Sahiba means to go alone? Asked Samina in wonder. Yes, alone, said Janki, and turned away from the light lest Samina notice her face. Months later, when they had been married and living most of the time in her own Sabzi Mandi house, married in the teeth of opposition from Manki, that's her mother, and Hashmatullah, her lawyer, and surprisingly even Akbar Sahib, the mist of that lit up night refused to leave her senses, continued to waken that flush of disbelief. To the coachman she had said, "Drive to the river first, Ramzani. I need some fresh air." As if that were enough, and the utterance of the destination used up all her remaining courage and left none to utter with decisive finality the name of the man she had chosen. And when they passed the river and she felt its cool breath upon her face, her shrinking brain broke into an involuntary prayer to it, her Ganga still, invisible in the night, but running alongside her like an inexorable fate, a proceeding karma, like the invisible blood coursing in her veins. And when the firelight from the hearts of the riverside ascetics, mingling with the glimmer of kerosene lanterns and the smoking oil beacons of squatting hawkers who lined the riverbank, fell upon the dark hem of water, she felt a tremor pass into her throat as she told the coachman to stop at a footpath spread with silver, a fish stall lit by a single earthen oil lamp. She made him turn the horses and head for Mehdori and ask the way to Wakil Sheikh Sahab Abdul Haq's house. To the old family servant who opened the gate, she had merely said, "Tell your master, a lady who has something important to tell him respecting the municipal elections is here." That had made it seem practical and regular in the servant's eyes and in the coachman's too. "Why have you united your heart with mine after an age?" Did he remember the past that he came again? The trapper took away the bulbul captive with him. In the garden, why did the trapper create this riot? I too have waited to see this sight. Why did Allah show such a sight to Moses on the mountain of Tur? Why did someone look this way with tender guilefulness? Why did he take aim at my heart? Oh, Janki, I am trying hard, intently. But why he should have forgotten me, what is the reason?
These are poems written originally in Urdu, but from her collection called Diwane Janki.
When she heard rapid steps on the paving stones and heard his cautious voice, hushed to a perplexed undertone, asking, "Who is it?" she refrained from lifting her veil and kept her voice brisk and even. "It is I, Janki Bai, Allahabadi," she said grandly, as she did at the close of her gramophone recordings, as though she were the empress of the city or the city itself, conferring a gracious visitation, granting a prize to one of its minor but favored citizens. "It isn't me," she had said, "but someone resembling me. For can you imagine Janki driving up alone at 9 in the night? And yet, this is someone who answers to my name." He had stepped close to the side of the phaeton. "My good fortune, whoever it is, I invite you to grace my threshold, Baiji. Will you not come in? I invite you to grace the kacheri tomorrow, Haq Sahab. Will you not come?" She signaled to the coachman to turn the horses round and click them on, calling over her shoulder her imperious command. "At 11 o'clock sharp, Haq Sahab, the kacheri." She made over the house in Hashmatullah's stiff and sullen presence, signing her name in her impeccable Urdu calligraphy alongside Abdul Haq's shaken masculine scrawl. It felt more like an outlandish nikah of destinies than a transfer of property.
they stood beneath the peeling paint of the crumbling arches. "My address, Baiji, is where yours is," he whispered, overcome, "if you will allow me." Then she threw back her veil and turned her proud, scarred face to his gaze. He understood and hastened to add, "A house is precious because of the way it makes us feel, the comfort and shelter it gives, not the way it looks to the eye." He respected and honored the scars left by time and by trouble. He caressed the cracked wall, the fissured trellis, and she came to him saying, "Do not look on me thus, Haq Sahib. That you should come to me in the darkness of the night like an angel of mercy." "No," she whispered. "I came in the dark that you may hear my voice alone, not see my uncomely form. I came on a moonless night, lest you see how pitted my face is." Lying in his arms, she chided him playful. "Oh, you are a lawyer, not a poet." "I am henceforth sightless," he had whispered in reply. "What argument stronger than love's appeal? Milord, I charge you with the larceny of my soul." The songs of her riyas put words to her desire. She knew exactly what it was to be taut as a bowstring ready to snap at a touch. "Mori angiya na chuo karungi kapolan lal, ye angiya nahi janak dhanush si chuvat toote tatkal. Touch not my bodice, else I shall smear thy cheek red. This is no mere bodice, but King Janak's bow. A touch can instantly snap its string." She closed her eyes and immersed herself in the overflowing excess of her imaginings. All shame cast aside, the conniving surrender. "Ab to tihari banaye chaliya, bahiya pakad mukh malat gulalwa, ab to sanki saheli dur nikas gai, ham hi akeli dar pe aaye." "Now I am all yours, O prankster, who grabs me by the arm and slathers my face red. My handmaidens have wandered afar. I alone have come to your door." It meanders on, and there is folklore, there is song, there is poetry. And the relationship between her and Abdul Haq is actually based on history, on her actual biography, because she had gifted him her house in order to win him over. So a lot of things mingle together, and they feed one another, and they add to the width of the stream of the river. I could read on, but I don't want to poach on anyone else's time now.
But such beautiful metaphors. Rivers flowing, rivers, water contained within different kinds of vessels. I'm going to ask Makaranji to enlighten us a little bit more, because you have such a breadth of genres that you cover as well. What is your idea about across genres?
A short correction about my CV. I have also written 5 novels. They have been translated also in various languages. And what I have written, a 3-volume book, is not an anthology of Marathi theatre, but it's a socio-political history of Marathi theatre. It's not anthology. Anyway, that's a technical thing. It's not that important. What is... I am asked to talk about my... writing. It's very difficult to do that. Maybe a few of you were present in the last session as well, and you have already heard it. So I won't be very elaborate about it. I'm an architect by profession. I started writing theatre. Actually, I started writing a film script. I come from Pune. Pune is a city which is a place where FTII is placed, the Film and Television Institute of India. There is a film archive, so you get to see films from all over the world, some fascinating films which you normally don't see in theatres. So actually it's a city of films, though Bombay is known to be the city of films. If you want to see films from all over the world, that is where in the Pune, that is where you get to see them. So I started with writing a film script. Now as you know, making a film is a very elaborate and very difficult process. I showed that script to Mr. Vijay Tendulkar, and he told me that okay, that it's a wonderful script. I will take it either to Shyam Benegal or Govind Nilani, and they will make a film on it. I said, no, I want to make the film myself. So he said, okay, go ahead. I was a stupid young man by then. At that time, I didn't know how difficult it was to make a film. So ultimately, but simultaneously, something else happened. There was a workshop organized by Ford Foundation. They also gave scholarships. And Tendulkar told me, why don't you write a play on it? So that's what turned me into a playwright. And I wrote many plays after that. That was basically that established my identity as a playwright. Then I turned to novels around 2001, because as she asked, does the novel come to you as a novel? I think it does. A play comes to you as a play. A novel comes to you as a novel. A history book comes to you as a history book. You do not think that, okay, this is the idea in my mind. These are the characters in my mind. Now, do I make a play of it? Do I make a novel of it, out of it? Do I make a short story out of it? Do I write a poem out of it? I think it comes with the form. We try to distinguish form and the content as if they are two separate things. Many a times form becomes content. Many a times content has its own form. In fact, usually in a good work of fiction, whether it is play or novel or short story, form essentially is part of the fiction. Not only form follows fictions, but many a time, or form follows the function, many a times form becomes part of content itself. So it is not diversified, like you decide that, okay, this is the content, this is the idea, etc. And now I will write a play on it. At least as far as I'm concerned, I'm not speaking as in general, at least as far as I'm concerned, that's what happens. A play comes to me as a play, a novel comes to me as a novel. Obviously, play has its own elements of life, dialogues, monologues, etc., etc., etc. Novel has a much wider kind of a platform, much wider space available to you. There are plots and the subplots, there are characters who can come and go. There is narrative which may not essentially be as tense as it is required to be in a play. Play is essentially made of conflict. Play essentially needs continuous tension throughout, right from A to Z. Novel does not need that. Novel can meander, as she said, it can be a river, it can flow at a different paces. Play has to have a kind of a rhythm which keeps you continuously under its kind of reins. A novel can meander, play cannot. So these are obviously pluses and minuses of each form. So then I turned to novel because a theme struck me as a novel, because it was a wild thing, because there were plots and the subplots, because there were numerous characters which could not be accommodated in a short span of a play. Then, because my plays and my novels are basically of theater of ideas, they are socio-political, they are experimental, I started thinking, why do I write this? Who am I? What are my ideas? From where do they come from? And then I realized that, okay, I have to think, I'm standing on somebody's shoulders here. There is a history of Indian writing, there is a history of world writing, there is history of Marathi theater. I am basically a Marathi writer. I do not write in English. I translate myself. My plays have been translated in various languages in India and abroad by different people as well. So then I thought that, okay, I stand on the shoulders of somebody. I have read Tendulkar, I have read Marathi writers, I have read Dostoevsky's and Camus and Kafka's. So what do I stand, whose shoulders do I exactly stand on? What were the ideas in Marathi theatre that were predominant in 1870s, say, or 1930s, or 1970s? They related to the socio-political reality then, they related to the kind of culture prevalent in those conditions. So I started looking out for something that would give me an idea of what ideas, what thinking process existed in different eras of Marathi theatre. Then I realized that no history of Marathi theatre, which would really talk about thinking, which would really talk about thought, about ideas, existed at all. So then I decided that, okay, I will write a short book on that. And I was awarded a India Foundation for the Art Fellowship for that. The idea basically was to write a couple of articles or a short book. But the material was so vast that I ended up writing for 2 years, and it ended up into an 1800-page, three-volume book that was also translated into English and published by Oxford University Press. So that's when another time that the genre changed. Now, simultaneously, an experimental playwright like me, everywhere in the world, I suppose, or when you claim that I am writing something different, when you claim that I have something else to say that the others have not said, whether that claim is right or wrong, whether that claim is superficial or in depth, one thinks of writing one's own manifesto. That is done in Europe quite a lot. Every new filmmaker writes his or her own manifesto and tries to tell that this is what I'm trying to say. You may understand it, you may not understand it, you may like it, you may not like it, you may agree with it, you may not agree with it. But this is what I'm trying to say. This is why I'm trying to say it also. So that's where the essays come in. Because my writing was sociopolitical and experimental, I thought that I did not think, the essays also came spontaneously, that I wanted to communicate in every way possible. At times, you have to go beyond the fiction. You have to address few issues directly. You have to take out your manifestos, in a sense. So my essays are, in a way, my manifesto. That's in short, but I spoke for a long time, I suppose, in short, about my travel through different genres.
That's so illuminating as well. So it seems from what I hear from all of you is that you're essentially, you have your nose to the ground and you're almost like following a scent, and the path unfolds as you go along. Am I kind of sensing that from all of you? That things are unfolding, you're answering questions, and I love what you said about, you know, you don't start out by thinking that I'm going to address this as a play, or I'm going to address this as a nonfiction sociopolitical history. But it almost is that you're answering some questions, and it's an organic kind of unfolding and the unpeeling of layers, like you said as well. And sometimes they are across genres as well. Now, I know from a background in classical music and dance, you know, you have to be very, very rooted in your vocabulary before you can experiment, before you can say that I'm going to do a piece of experimental dance, or I'm going to, you know, go off into experimental music. But you have to be completely rooted in your very, very strong in your vocabulary. How do you go about that? How do you go about acquiring that training? Because I know there are writers amongst the audience who want to figure out that, okay, this cross-genre thing is very good for expert writers like you on the panel, but how do I go about it? How do I address this question? Where are my roots? What is my training? What are the strategies?
I was more fortunate in that I am a very rooted person. I have lived in the city of Allahabad, and it's been nourishing my work, all the dimensions of my work, in so many different ways, whether it is language, whether it is music, whether it is the unconscious vibrations of thought which are ingrained in a culture. So that way, it was not an effort. I had to practice some kind of negative capability and allow my environment to speak to me. Sometimes it spoke to me as song, sometimes it spoke to me as poetry, sometimes it spoke to me as in Awadhi, sometimes it spoke to me in Bhojpuri, sometimes in Urdu. I had to listen. And because I was anchored there, because I was rooted there, I would say that I had an instinctive ear to listen to the book as it came along.
Mishi, would you care to comment on that as well? What is your response to something like that? Where does the freewheeling come in? Where does the rootedness come in?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question. I mean, I think I have exactly the opposite situation, where I'm deeply unrooted and deracinated, if you will, and kind of feel like I'm blowing in the wind in a bit, in a sense. But I think this is why, and because I've been influenced by, you know, I speak Hindi in a way that was my mother tongue, but I think and breathe in English and write in English. But I've also studied Chinese and I speak French, and in a funny way, all these different languages kind of become this big hodgepodge, and maybe that's why I find myself deeply drawn to poetry, because in a way poetry throws out all the rules of language and pulls you into the center of emotion. And in a way, for me, that's what I'm trying to head towards, is how do I get away from all those traditions, in fact, and then just create something that is pure, that cuts through all those boundaries. And maybe it's my choice of, or my being drawn to this world, this lost world in the 1920s and 30s of Shanghai, and set in a very local Chinese kind of situation, is my way of getting away from those boundaries and trying to create a whole new world that has no antecedents anywhere.
Would you?
I would like to make two points here about the question that you asked. I think it is slightly different from all literature than music or painting or dance. I mean different by without any value content added to it. Literature basically is not as abstract as music or painting or dancing. Literature, as in Sanskrit it is called, it is arthanugami. It goes behind the meaning. So the basic idea of literature, many times it is portrayed as reflecting the reality. But it is not actually, in my opinion, it does not reflect the reality, otherwise every literature will be same. It is actually recreating the reality. It is finding the meaning in the reality in your own way and putting it in words. The basic, that's the second point, the basic weather vital of literature or writing is given to you from schools. I mean, we learn our ABCD in schools. So there's nothing different. That then you cultivate your own vocabulary by reading, by thinking. My grandmother was absolutely illiterate. She had never learned any, she had never gone to any school. She had never received any formal training. But she was a fascinating poet, and not only fascinating poet in the general sense, she was a staunch feminist poet at that. I mean, if she would be alive now, she would be around 110 or something like that. So it comes by making the meaning of the reality around you on your own. And any literature that is worth its salt is literature of ideas, and it necessarily recreates the reality and gives meaning. That's why her book is so important, because everybody knows about the protagonist. What she has done is to interpret that protagonist to give the reality her own meaning, and that is why the book becomes important. That is the vision of the writer, and that is the meaning that the writer makes. It is not only the reflection.
So now all of you have talked about, your books are set deeply in historical context. I know, Mishi, you've entered this world of the 1930s, Shanghai. Neelum, you have recreated Allahabad at a certain point of time. Your plays, again, are very, very rooted, and your novels as well, very rooted in certain historical context. Where does the responsibility lie as a writer to say that, you know, this is rooted in history and in research? Today morning I heard something about archival adventures, that you've probably done a lot of work in archives to be able to recreate that kind of sense and the reality that you're talking about. But where do you, how do you distinguish this for the reader? Because I'm asking from the reader's point of view, how do I know that what I'm reading in your work is not completely history? It is, you've added in bits, which is your writerly bit. You've added in your bits, but it's completely, 1930 Shanghai is very much there, but the characters are your own, what their lives are your own. So How do you go about something like that? Where do you distinguish your responsibility?
Actually, if I can start, my plays are not rooted in history. They are all in contemporary reality, apart from one play, that is historical play. Not historical play, but the characters are from history. A few of the characters are from history. That is mainly Socrates and Plato. But most of my plays are rooted in the sense they are rooted in the culture that I live in, that are rooted in the language I live in the city I live in, etc., etc. So I'm not really in a position to answer your question as far as rooting in history is concerned. But I am extremely interested in the reading all the historical novels, all the historical plays. But when I want to write about history through fiction, I would be certainly looking at its relevance in today's reality. Because my writing is basically socio-political and experimental writing. Unless the part of history that I'm talking about is relevant to today's reality, I myself would not be interested in the writing about it. Though I will be interested in reading about it.
I would address this question in this way. There are documented facts. As you study in preparation to write, you have to educate yourself in the authentic facts, in the recorded facts. Also, you are free to question those facts. But having got the facts under control, there are the great human moments. There are gaps. And that is where you take your flight of imagination. And that is where you also become an actor. You stop being the writer, but you become the character and you enact the character. You attract the vibrations of that character's personality. It's a kind of invocation. You become the character and you perform on the page. And the stage that which you perform is that silent area between the authentic facts. So the facts are there. They are the skeleton. But you flesh it out through your imagination and through your enactment. You are responsible never to be unfaithful to the facts. But we must also know that history leaves all the great moments of drama. They are unimportant, they are irrelevant. Those are the great emotional moments, the great moments of reflection and insight, the epiphanies, and that is the ether that you breathe when you write a work of art out of history.
The word she used, enactment, is very interesting, because an actor, like an actor, imbibes a character that he or she is playing, internalizes it, and becomes, in a sense, not exactly one with the character. You can't think that you're a king if you're playing a king. So, but there is a certain sort of internalization that is required there. In the same way, an author needs to internalize all the characters that he or she is writing about. So that internalization is this enactment. That's what I think.
Yeah, I think Neelum put that extremely well about the gaps in the history and what is happening. And that was certainly true as well of my monk book, where I'm talking about Xuanzang. And there's places where I found myself imagining what he thought and felt, none of which was in the history books and none of which was in his own records either. And it's exactly these gaps which are the ones that you want to inhabit when you're writing historical fiction, even for the 1920s Shanghai novel. And then you hope you get it right. You hope you hit some truth that is beyond the historical detail and beyond the stage that you have chosen to unspool your story, if you will.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to go back and ask you a few more questions once we are back in the lounge, because I'm really interested. I know you're writing contemporary plays, but I'm thinking about somebody maybe 50 years from now is probably going to read your play and say that, you know, this was a reflection of what was happening at that time. And I think that's because you probably have your ear very, very close to the ground. And you're reflecting that reality that you are seeing. And the form is choosing itself in your plays and in the other forms that we've just talked about. We've got about 10 minutes left. And I'm happy to open the floor to questions. And there'll be a mic around. So if you have any questions, please, please do raise them for the panelists.
Hello, my question is, are there any boundaries during writing the historical fiction in which you are restricted while taking the flight of imagination?
The facts are the boundaries. Now that is a contested word. When we say something is historical fact, that too is an act of faith. You believe that, the books say that, you have heard that. However, in good faith, you accept that as the limit that you must not cross. But within that, there is a pretty wide margin of freedom where you can take your flight of imagination.
Hello. No, just to clarify a bit, I think you are talking about the objectivity and subjectivity part of it also. Even history writing, straight history writing, not only fiction, but plain history writing can never be 100% objective. It is always biased because you have to choose. Suppose you take a historical figure like Socrates or Plato, you cannot write by stating, okay, he got up on that Monday morning, then he was not feeling well, and etc., etc., etc. So you choose a few facts from that person's life and say that these are historically important facts. Now, which facts you choose to be historically important makes you subjective. So which facts you choose while writing fiction in the historical sense also makes you subjective. There is a continuous tension between the subjective and the objective, whether you are writing fiction or non-fiction. And this tension, how you resolve, is what makes the book.
In this context, what would you see as the scope of abstraction, of imagery, of visualization? Are we constrained or is it not a boundary?
Sorry, what do you mean visualization? I mean,
see, many a times, like you said, the form comes along with the so-called content when you're thinking about writing, be it poetry, be it fiction, be it non-fiction. Many a times that is also perhaps spearheaded by certain visuals that we see, certain imagery that we see. Again, even if it is rooted in the historical context or in the socio-political context. But here, given the relevance of the context today, do you feel that there is a scope for abstraction? For instance, when I'm writing a poetry, the scope of abstraction there, is it limited in your case when you're writing?
I take that. When you use the word abstraction, I'll borrow Makarand's word manifesto. Because when we come to reflection in a work of art, whether it is a play, whether it is a novel or a poem, that is the presence of the author. That is the authorial consciousness, no matter how subtly it conceals itself. So I would say that the author exists there, exists quietly, invisibly, but becomes visible through the reflections, through the insights, you know, the viewpoints. And I do think that every work of art must have its inner thought. It must have its inner argument. And that argument must point towards some great human truth. So I would definitely say there is more than scope. It is desirable to have abstraction somewhere concealed behind the material facts.
Well, I think that you choose, there are boundaries, but you've chosen them yourself. You've decided to put your novel in a particular era, in a particular time. So those are the boundaries you've set for yourself. But I think that, you know, that's this thing of subjectivity and the author being that. I'm so glad you brought up subjectivity, because it's not just nonfiction that is subjective. Even news is subjective. So
completely.
Every single thing that you write down is a point of view.
I talk about everything being an act of curation. I mean, how you present yourself, how you present news, how you present any piece of writing. It's what you choose to put in is as important as what you choose to leave out. You know, whether you are putting up a Facebook post, for instance, or an Instagram post, everything is an act of curation. So that's what I think.
Good morning, panel. What do you think of the prospect of a movie being made on your works? Will you be gladdened by the fact that your work will now cater to a larger audience, or be slightly saddened by the fact that the historical facts will be probably be watered down to make it more glamorous?
I'd be happy because I'll be paid more. But that's a different story. It is not necessary that the film will lighten, or it will kind of dilute the whole thing. It will depend on how a film is made. I mean, if a film is made by Satyajit Ray on my novel, I mean, I know he's no longer there, but if a person as capable as Satyajit Ray does a film on my novel, I'll be extremely happy. In fact, I would choose which director is making a film on the novel or not.
Author Sunil Gangopadhyay was not very happy with the way Satyajit Ray projected Arunyad Dinraj.
Yes, I know, but still that risk is worth taking, because then it will be, never will a writer be happy. I can tell you as a playwright, because when my plays are directed by somebody else, I'm not happy. Very rarely would I be happy, because there are two visions that come in. But when the different vision, even if it is different from your own, if it is as deep or as wide as that of Ray's, then there is bound to be some kind of mutual respect.
I think it's really interesting, because we've just jumped another genre. We've actually now entered the film world as well. So I think that was a really interesting question. Thank you.
Hello, ma'am. Good evening. Bonjour, madame. Yo, ma'am. My question is to you. You said you can speak French. Je m'appelle Kapil et j'enseigne à DPS Delhi Public School à Jaipur ici. So my question is, do you write something in French and something in Chinese? And how did this idea came to your mind learning, like, for example, French? How did it happen? So could you please elaborate that, and so that I may also develop my interest learning Chinese language as well and other languages. But I'm more interested in learning Spanish. Merci.
Some of it was an accident. My father with his job, he was posted to Switzerland when I was 10 years old. He used to work for Nestle, and the headquarters of Nestle are in Vevey in Switzerland. And my mother, she was moving from India. She had three young children, and she had to just figure everything out in this French-speaking place. And she decided to put us in a French school, and we were in the mountains. So we used to walk up the hill to the school with all the other little French kids, and we had to learn French very quickly. But kids pick it up, and everything was in French. Maths was in French, geography was in French. We were the only Indian family in that little Swiss village. So that's how the French happened. The Chinese was actually a decision. I remember I was on my way to college, and the flight stopped in Hong Kong, and we were visiting some friends in Hong Kong, and they took us to Kowloon, which is on the mainland side of Hong Kong. And my friend's father, he just pointed and he said, you know, that's mainland China. And I sort of had this heart-stopping moment going, oh my God, there's China. And so I got to college, and in American colleges, you know, subjects, it's like a buffet. You get this course catalog and you pick and choose, and you kind of And so I saw Chinese language. The Chinese language was offered as a course. And just on a whim, because I like languages, I like the sound of different languages, I love listening to different kinds of languages. But I had never come across a language like Chinese, which was so ideographic and pictorial. And I thought, how is it possible that I don't know anything about this? And so I began to study it just on a whim. And I took a year of, you know, we had these old Chinese teachers. One was from Taiwan, Ma Lao Shi, like Professor Ma. And we had a quiz every single morning at 8:30, a test, because that is, I mean, and maybe there's something slightly masochistic about that whole exercise, which appealed to me. Anyway, at the end of that 1 year of studying Chinese, I thought, well, this is silly. I've studied this Chinese language for a year, and I don't know anything about China. And so I applied for this exchange program as a student and spent a year in Beijing as a language student. And of course, that was 89, which was Tiananmen Square. So there I was as a young student kind of cycling to Tiananmen Square, watching these demonstrations. And then it became kind of this big question in my head. What happened in Tiananmen Square? What did that mean? What did that, you know, and in a sense, Tiananmen Square is what launched my whole search for history and for answers and maybe for language as well.
Thank you. Thank you to all of you. I've had a lovely afternoon. I hope you have too.
We wish to thank our speakers, Neelum Saran Gour, Mishi Saran, Makarand Sathe, and Ranu Bhattacharya for this lovely session on across genres. The Z Jaipur Literature Festival is proud to partner with Air Asia India, part of the Tata Group, to raise awareness about the climate and work towards a greener and more substantial future. Together, we are creating a literature forest and individual trees in honor of the speakers at JLF to reduce the carbon footprint by planting trees. One tree can offset 20 kg of carbon in a year. This afternoon, we are honoring our speakers with certificate for this initiative. Can we please applaud for them?
One? How many?
Yeah, only one.